Jonathan Goldman, founder and director of New England Sound Healers, a nonprofit organization dedicated to research and awareness of the use of sound and music for well-being. My guest is Dr. Peter Guy Manners. Peter Guy Manners is a doctor from England. He holds a number of different degrees, including Doctor of Medicine, Doctor of Osteopathy, as well as PhDs from both Oxford and Heidelberg University. He has researched and worked with Dr. Hans Jenny of Basel, Switzerland, Professor Gaveau of the Sorbonne in Paris, France, Dr. Brunner of Heidelberg, Germany, and George Delaware at the Delaware Laboratories in Oxford, England. Since 1961, Dr. Manners has been applying his knowledge of the effects of sound for healing into the development of cymatics, which is now internationally known and used in various parts of the globe. His Bretfordan Hall Clinic in Worcestershire, England, specializes in the use of cymatic therapy, the direct application of sound on the body for healing. Dr. Manners, it is a pleasure to have you here.
Thank you, Jonathan. It's very nice to be back here, too.
Well, I wonder if you could tell us, what exactly is cymatics? That is it a new form of therapy, or is it something that is very ancient, very old? What can you tell us about it?
Well, basically, it is not something which is new. It has been researched over a long period of time. A lot of research has gone into the work, and it has been in use for approximately 20 years in our clinic in Worcestershire. But over and above that, you ask, is it very old? Yes, it is very old. The concept of sound or music or any of these type of things is as old practically as man himself. But in cymatic therapy, we have adapted it into the modern idiom, and now it is used in a technological way, which is scientifically approved, medically acceptable, and is in use in many clinics throughout the world.
Is there some sort of history of the use of sound or music being used in ancient civilizations? I've heard that stories of this type of...
Oh, yes, many of them. We have worked... in the research field, and in order to work in the research field, you have to go backwards as well as forward. And we have traveled into many countries examining the techniques anywhere where there's been any suggestion that sound of any type was used. We found great evidence of that amongst the American Indians, where they used sound and vibration to heal the sick. In Greece, in Egypt, in China, in Mexico, in Brazil, in practically all the countries it has been used. Also in biblical times, of course, music and the formation of sound into a music form was used with very great success, and you'll find great evidence of this in your Bible.
The Bible, how so?
There are many references to calming the savage beast with music, and also we all remember the story of King Saul and the harpist that he always had to relieve his tension, his stress, and his strain.
Young David, I believe it was.
Precisely.
Yes, yes, indeed. Pythagoras, who we know as the father of geometry, was also involved in this work. Is that true? Or
Yes, that's perfectly true, but also the temples of Delphi. We have discovered comparatively recently that music and sound was one of the concepts of their healing technique. A lot of the stories which have been written concerning the temples of Delphi are not wholly correct. And we found that the pulsation of beating notes and music was one of the therapies which they used.
Fascinating, fascinating. Now, is cymatic therapy, what is it though? Is it sound? Is it music? Is it something you play from a tape recorder?
Well, of course, when you refer to sound, everyone sort of associates it with something that you listen to. With cymatics, this is not precisely so. It is literally the transplanting or the transmutation of accepted frequencies of sound into the tissue and structure of the human being. All the areas of the body, all the organs of the body, produce a harmonic, a sound. This sound is very small and very minute. This again is not a new concept, not a new theory, but it is only in comparatively recent years that technology has caught up with the concepts and the ideas of this, and we've been able to reproduce these frequencies and sounds. And now we can reproduce them, create them artificially, and transfer them back into the tissue and the structure. A lot of our doctors are referring it to transplant because technically, I suppose, this is what we are doing. We are transplanting the corrected frequencies back into the structure to replace any abnormalities that exist there. Mm. Also, of course, one of the strongest points which we advocate is that we can use this in place of drugs and medicine. And if we can replace medicine with treatment, we find this is much better. It takes a little more time and you have to have a little more attention from your individual practitioner or your doctor. But then that is one of the things which we are trying to push forward at the present moment, that the medical profession treats every individual as a holistic being rather than a condition.
Mm-hmm. So you're saying that there are different frequencies for different parts of the body, and that with cymatic therapy, you would somehow inject or put in the correct frequency that is needed for that part of the body. Is that correct?
That's correct. You see, every part of the body possesses a harmonic, whether it's the harmonic of the heart, the lungs, the liver, the kidney, muscles, bones, nerves, whatever it is, it produces a harmonic. This harmonic is now tabulated, we know what they are, and we can reform these artificially on a computer. Mm-hmm. Then it can be played back into the structure and the system. It is pleasant, it is easy, it is comfortable, there's no side effects. There are literally no conditions where it cannot be used, except if the patient has a heart pacer, but then that applies to all techniques of treatment if the patient has a heart problem there. But other than that, there are no conditions that can't be treated. Even in pregnancy cases, we've treated them right up to the time of delivery.
Mm-hmm. Now, cymatics, what does the word mean?
Well, in its early stages, which was now over 20 years ago, it was called sonic medicine or sonic therapy. Mm-hmm. But the general public got this confused with ultrasonics, which is quite understandable. So therefore, we changed the name to cymatics. Cymatics is a Greek word meaning pressure or waves. While we are using pressure waves combined with the sound, so it's perfectly technically correct. Also, it pays tribute to one of the doctors whose groundwork formulated this concept and this therapy, and this was Dr. Hans Jenny of Bâle in Switzerland. And he called his form of research cymatic research. He did invaluable work. But what we have done is to bring the research of various physicists and doctors and scientists together, the list that you've already quoted, bring those together, and out of that we have evolved a technique of treatment which is now internationally known and is used right throughout the world.
Mm-hmm. Dr. Jenny's work has been published in a couple of books.
That's correct. There are two books which are beautifully illustrated and shows the formation of shapes and forms that can be created by various frequencies of sound. He lectured very, very little. He objected to standing on a platform and lecturing, but he did make records of all his work. He made film of it. He took photographs of it. The books were illustrated from it. And just before he died, he passed all his research over to us so that we could amalgamate it and fit it with other concepts of therapy. There's one doctor which we have left out in your list, and he was very, very important, and that's Dr. Harold Saxon Burr. Without the concepts that he formulated, we shouldn't be in the position we are today. It's only thanks to these people who have laid the foundations on which we can construct this therapy that we owe so very much to.
Dr. Saxon Burr was associated with Yale University?
He was at Yale University,
and
yes.
His main work involved?
His main work was being able to discover that you can measure the frequencies of radiation outside of the body. When he first postulated this theory, I mean, it was mistrusted. I mean, at that day and time, I mean, very little was known about it, and no one quite went along with what he was saying. But fortunately, before he left this planet, he was able to come back to Yale University, and I think the expression is his picture was turned away from facing the wall, and there's now a picture on the wall again. Because he was a very famous and a very talented man, and the work that he did was absolutely invaluable in the fields of research. And we find that now we're moving more and more into this field of research, that more and more of the technical truths which he wrote up and experimented with are of invaluable use to us.
What are your basic principles of using sound or cymatic therapy as a healing tool?
In the first and early days of this, we kept it locked into the use of muscular diseases, bone diseases, joint deformities, rheumatism, arthritis, fibrositis. Now, we kept it into these various diseases for several purposes. The main one was to accumulate as much information and knowledge and case histories as we possibly could to validate our concept and our theory. But also there was other things coming to the concept, and that was it was very easy to treat because you treated the surface of the body. But as it has gone along over the past 20 years, we have found now that we can treat all parts of the body and including the internal organs. And year by year, we are having reports fed back to us from various doctors and clinics that are using the instrumentation that are feeding back new results and new points are coming to light.
Perhaps you could enlighten us a bit more about how exactly you could use a sound or tone to counteract a disease or something that is not balanced properly in the body.
Well, if every organ and every part of the human anatomy gives off a signal, providing all those signals are in line with the general harmonic of the whole body, then you are in good health. But if for any reason, irrespective of what it is, if for any reason any of those frequencies fall out of alignment, then you are diseased or out of harmony, disharmonic. Also, another thing which is very important is that this simplifies to a large extent the method of administering treatment or administering medicine. You see, a lot of these instruments are now being developed for third world countries. Now, we can't hope to train third world people directly into medicine over a short space of time. And if we don't do something quickly, I mean, many people are going to be in dire pain and straits of which no help is done, because I mean there are far too few medical practitioners to be able to deal with the amount of people that need help and treatment. Therefore, the effect of diagnosing a condition is not so vitally important. If you're dealing with it medically, a diagnosis is vitally important, because otherwise you'd administer the wrong medication. But if you're dealing with some internal organ that is out of alignment and you're assessing it by its vibrational force field, then providing you can correct, or there's some method or some technique that can correct this vibrationary force field, irrespective of the condition which is causing it, you're on the right track. Mm-hmm. So therefore, many people can be helped merely by injecting the frequency back into the structure. And what also you've got to remember is that the frequency you're injecting is the natural frequency. You're working hand in hand with nature. You're not doing anything contrary to nature, because the adverse condition is contrary to nature. So therefore, if you're putting in the corrected frequency and signal, the human structure is very keen to get back into alignment. This is one of the principal problems that have been in the organ transplant in surgery. It is the harmonic concept. Everything is taken into consideration when a transplant is done, whether it's by kidney transplant or heart transplant. Everything is taken into consideration. But up until a short while ago, we gave no consideration to the harmonic. And therefore, if the harmonic of that transplanted heart is not in line with the harmonics of the rest of that system, we use the term the body rejects the transplant. This is merely what it means. It rejects it because the harmonic evaluation of that heart will not fit in with the rest of the harmonics of the system in the body.
So in other words, in order to utilize a sound or a series of harmonics as a healing tool, what you would do is you would inject this into the body, and that which was diseased or vibrating out of harmony or ease with the rest of the body would somehow resonate back to its proper frequency.
Back to its proper frequency. But one thing we've got to be careful in this, you use the word inject. Now, if we use the word inject, a lot of people think we're going to stick a needle into them and inject something. We transmit it into the system. So the system is easy. There is no breaking of skin or surface. No needles are used. It is an application which is applied to the surface of the body. And if you apply sound in the audible range to the surface of the body, it will transmit itself right straight through the body and out the other side. Now, if there's nothing organically incorrect in the area through which that travels, it will travel straight through and be rejected on the far side. No harm will be done, no damage will be done. But if there's any abnormality in the frequency of the area that you're projecting the frequency field to, then it will rectify that as it passes through. And merely by simply placing the hand on the far side to which the applicator is applied, you can tell whether the condition is advanced, or whether it's very bad, or whether it's very slight. Because if the frequency signal travels through very quickly, there is very little wrong in that area. But if it takes some seconds or a minute before it travels through, then you know it's meeting obstacles on its passage through the structure.
What sort of cases have you worked with?
Well, we've dealt actually, well, I mean, over that period of time with many thousands of cases. The early work in the early days was muscular rheumatism, arthritis, fibrositis, and the point was to treat these people. Now, in advanced cases, we particularly chose advanced cases in some cases to see how long or how much improvement we could get, where medically speaking, we said it was incurable and gone too far. In some of these cases, the patients had had rheumatic disorders or arthritic disorders for a period of 30 years. They were elderly people. In many of these cases, we were able to stabilize the condition and prevent further deterioration. But in lots of cases, we got improvement, and if we got cases early enough, then we got a cure. But since then, many, many cases have been dealt with which have no sort of relationship to the cases we started off with. I mean, we've treated heart conditions, lung conditions, bronchial conditions, intestinal troubles. Most of these conditions now can all be treated by this technique and this method.
And you have some slides that you're going to show us, which may tell us a little bit about the effects of sound on some of the inorganic matter.
Well, that is correct, because a lot of these slides are were originally done by Dr. Hans Jenny, showing the effect on substance and liquids and fluids of particular sound frequencies. Now, although they have no medical validity at this particular point in time, because we've moved on further to that, they are interesting in as much as you can see the effect And I think it's always more convincing if you can see rather than just to hear what someone's talking about. So therefore, if you look at the film, if you look at these slides, you will see how the intricate patterns which we can formulate in substance can be changed merely by altering the frequency fields.
Mm-hmm. Well, let's take a look at some of these now.
We're going to show you now a few slides to give you some idea, because I think if you get a visual interpretation of what we have been discussing, you get a better impression of exactly what we're doing, where we can go, what we can create, and what we can form. It is scientifically correct to say that shape and form owe their shape and form solely to sound. And by these slides, we are able to show you how that shape and form can be held and repeated as many times as we wish, merely by the use of sound. Here we show one single drop of water placed on a plate to which the frequency field has been attached. By this means, we've been able to make it visual for you to see the geometric forms that can be formed when the cymatic frequency is filled into the structure. Here we have just one single drop of water vibrating at a low frequency. The low frequency gives the illusion that it is almost solid or semi-solid. It is not, it is just clear tap water and nothing more. Now, if we change that frequency, we can change the form and the shape. This is again the same drop of water as in the previous picture, but the frequency field has changed. We have changed it, and so long as that frequency exists, this shape and form will maintain its hold. It will act in this particular way every time this frequency is placed into the plate, which is the dark area around the outside. If we change the frequency back, we can reverse it back to the previous one. But each time we change, so the frequency modulates the single drop of water that's showing on the plate. Here again, we have the same metal plate and the same drop of water. We haven't changed the water in any way, exactly the same water, but again, we have changed the frequency field. Within this, we are using single frequencies and not the multiple frequencies of the cymatic instrument. But as the frequency goes higher, you will notice that the design within it becomes a little more ethereal. In other words, we are seeing more spaces between. But even so, the spaces are still contained water. Again, same plate, same water. But again, the frequency has changed, and we're becoming a little more ethereal again. It's gradually tightening up onto these areas and sparsing out in these areas, making the design a little more ethereal, looking less solid, in other words. Now, if the frequency field was changed back, we could recreate any one of these back in line or move them up in line. We can recreate this time and time again and make the same patterns over and over again. Now, here we have a complete change both of the material that we're using and also the frequency field that's being fed in. This was our first realization that we could, apart from making a flat diagrammatic form on the plate, we could evolve it into a three-dimensional figure or form. What we are feeding into here is five frequencies into the plate, which causes this malleable plastic to lift up, to formulate into this form and shape, and fold itself into the center groove along the top. It's in constant movement, but keeping the constant form and shape. This was the first realization that the cymatic concept and the cymatic principle could formulate a design and a pattern which was in similarity aligned to the formation structures within the human body. Now, here we have a picture of cellular development, showing exactly how the cell structure forms and how this interrelating form folds into this center crevice. It is a moving mass the whole time, moving in constantly, enfolding within itself. Here we have something which is just plastic, it's pliable plastic, but we're feeding a field into it which will create the same movement and basically the same form of the structure as the natural one that preceded it. Here again we have another picture of a cell development dividing into the four concepts and the outer rim around the outside. Again, in a constant state of enfoldment, one side from the outer moving into the inner from all four sides in a constant state. If this was on a moving picture, it would look like a living amoeba pulsing and moving. We have another picture which is very similar in appearance to the last one that we showed you, but this one is again plastic, being formulated into this shape and form by a cymatic frequency. Except that here we have, if you notice, there are five areas within it instead of four. But the same action is taking place, an enfolding movement from the outer rim to the inner points, from the outer rim to the inner points. In other words, like a living, evolving mass. But it owes its life wholly and solely to the vibration or the frequency field that's being fed into it and nothing else. Here we have a very highly magnified picture of the forefinger of a newborn child, showing the sort of cell development that is in on the skin surface. This is lycopodium dust vibrating at a similar frequency, formulating itself up into again these small center points, almost a replica of the cell formation of the child's fingers. Now, as you can see by the slides that you have seen, we can reproduce the most fantastic shapes and forms. We can almost duplicate parts of the human anatomy and structure merely by putting the correct frequency into place and utilizing it. These things can be reproduced as many times as we want. Again and again, we can reproduce them and watch them almost like living shapes, living forms, living amoeba. But they owe their life wholly and solely to sound, and perhaps we do too.